Oh, praise Jesus. Hallelujah. Father God, we just praise your holy name. We just praise your holy name. Thank you, Jesus. I consecrate myself with this holy oil in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Here we are. The Peterson Chronicles, Angel Wars and the Luciferian Rebellion, show number 66. Glory to God. And, you know, the situation around the earth is, you know, it is what it is. Korea's shooting at each other, north and south. I mean, they've shot before, but they, you know, and like they're doing right now. Now, supposedly, the news is saying that they're going to, you know, get together and have a discussion about it. But we already know what's going to happen. We're just kind of in the waiting game. Praise Jesus. Hopefully you're spending time on your knees, you know, before the Lord every single day, talking to him, you know, asking the Father to fill you with his love, to change you, to sanctify you, to prepare you. You know, if you're not prepared with the absolute outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon your life, being utterly, utterly changed, well, you will simply just not be able to deal with the things that are about to befall the earth. And it's going to be worldwide. It's not just going to be the United States of Babylon the Great. It'll be all over the world. It'll be World War III. Again, if you take a look, you know, at Ecclesiastes 1:9, whereby it, in essence, it scripturally says that, you know, if we want to know what's going to happen, all we got to do is look at the patterns of the past. There's nothing new under the sun. And surely enough, that's exactly what's going to happen. Some people would argue based upon that premise, that we've already entered into World War III, that the, global skirmish level that we have going on with the Ukraine and, other parts of the, world, with Syria, the United States of Babylon the Great sending in, jets to go in and bomb, the ISIS creation, which they made. So, you know, it's praise God. Oh, it's just amazing. Once your eyes are open to these things, you're just like, are you kidding me? It's like, it gets to the point where it's really kind of hard to watch, but we have to humble ourselves before the Lord and realize that this is his movie. This is his timeline. This is his work, and he's a merciful God, and our Father is going to do everything he possibly can to wake people up. And we just, and those of us who have been awakened or whatever for the last, you know, golly, in some cases now for me, it's approaching well over 10 years. You know, it's just very hard. It's very hard because, you know, and then you get to the point in your walk where you're seeking the Lord so much and you just want to be completely full of Jesus all the time, and you separate yourself from society, and then you get to this point where you don't even hardly, you know, you want, like, I like it. I enjoy a good science fiction show. I love science fiction because I don't think it's science fiction. I think it's science fact. I think Brother Peterson agrees with me. Now, how much of it is fact versus how much of it is, you know, contrived or whatever for the sake of, you know, making things interesting, we don't know. We're going to have to wait until we stand before Jesus. But when we take, you know, but when you're sitting in, and my point being that when you even just pick a sci-fi movie, pick Falling Skies, whatever, on TNT, pick whatever you want to watch. The nice thing about the sci-fi shows is that, you know, typically, you know, depending on the program, there's a whole vast majority of them that are, you know, not full of a tremendous amount of violence or anything like that. There's no bad words being used. So you can watch them and you can be intrigued by them and kind of enjoy the journey, as it were, you know, the mental journey. Praise Jesus. So I do enjoy watching science fiction programs. Praise God. But then you got to put up with these doggone TNT commercials, and they're just gushing with filth and abominable. Anyway, so praise God, I had to, last night I tried to get a little bit of escape time, a little bit of downtime, you know, watching a little bit of, sci-fi, and unfortunately get bombarded with these commercials about things that really shouldn't even be on television. If you took a person back from the 1940s, 1950s, and you beamed them into the, you know, you had them walk through a Stargate and into the, you know, 2015, and they sat in front of a television and saw the stuff that's on our commercials, they would, you know, even if they were a sinner, they would be aghast. They would be like, what? Can you, what did that person say? And nowadays it's just, you know, filth, and so many people accept it as the norm. But anyway, yeah, so if you're kind of like Brother Peterson and myself and Brother Kenneth, you know, and you believe that science fiction isn't really science fiction, that to some degree or another, it's science fact. And it's fascinating, too, because when you start piecing this all together and you realize, you know, hey, wait a minute, there are, you know, so many civilizations over thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of years of time. If you just take the timeline that goes back 6,000 years, you know, arguably, you know, a clean 6,000 years back to the Adamic bloodline, you know, Adam and Eve in a garden, providing that that's all contiguous, you know, based upon the genetic breakdowns and the genealogies that are mentioned in the scripture, to the best of our understanding, we're talking roughly about 6,000 years, and slightly over that. And anyway, so if you look at just that timeline alone, and you gather all of the ancient texts that we have, you know, like that you hear about all the time on shows like Ancient Aliens, which I love. I love Ancient Aliens because I think that with the exception of their hypothesis and their incorrect conclusions that they draw, the basic archaeological facts and figures are in essence correct, which makes it really fascinating because you have to piece it together and put it back against the Holy Bible. You know, anything that we can establish as being ultimately true, when you're able to hold, you know, something in your hand and you say, here it is, boom, and you set it on the table and you go, look at that right there. Find out where that belongs in the Bible. That's when it starts getting interesting, you know, I just think that when you look at the science fiction, when you look at the science fiction that you can pretty much estimate based upon, you know, archaeological, forbidden archaeology and things that have been established from multiple sources from across the world, and you look at the ancient texts and how, you know, and how can anybody say, you know, like, for example, that the ancient texts are just mythology? How is it that you can have, for example, an ancient civilization on one side of the earth during a time of the earth's existence where supposedly nobody had the ability to travel across the globe, right? And they're all writing about the same thing. Lizard men and dragon creatures and Kukulkan and all this kind of stuff. And they're all practicing the same types of rituals. They're chopping people's heads off, drinking blood, eating their hearts, killing babies, all that kind of stuff. You know, all the kind of same stuff it's talking about and that he, you know, that's in the Old Testament, the land of Canaan. When you start looking at that and you're like, wait, oh my gosh. You know, when your assumption, when you look at all those ancient texts, you know, the practices of the things that went down in Chichen Itza, you know, with the Mayans, and oh gosh, you go back to the ancient Chinese, the ancient Japanese, all of these, you know, writings, the Hindus, the lands of Pakistan, where Mohenjo-Daro, where you got the rock that's fused into glass, and the only way rock can be made into glass is ultimately by nuclear explosions taking place. There's even raised levels of nuclear, you know, background nuclear radiation that they can detect even today that would be, you know, or would be typical of a region that had nuclear bombs going off. And when they date these ancient digs, they're like, holy mackerel, this is like, you know, 3000 BC, that kind of thing. And you know, well, who was nuking who 3000 BC? You know, why are there these drawings and cave drawings, for example? Why are there cave petroglyphs, you know, cave drawings at the upper altitudes of the Andes Mountains in South America, with you know, like devil creatures with horns coming out of their heads and spirals. There's like spirals right beside devil creatures and people running up the sides of mountains to get away from flowing water. With dead animals laying all over the place and broken trees, and they're scampering up the sides of mountains to get away from inrushing water. Why would they draw that? Why would they take the time to chisel those into perpetual existence for historical record, obviously? I mean, if it didn't happen. Why would the ancient cultures, as difficult as it was to record ancient writings and such, why would they go to the trouble of doing the things that they did? They didn't have computers. They didn't hit the print key and a bunch of stuff prints out. They had to go to a lot of trouble, a lot of trouble, and in many cases, tremendous amounts of expense. Go back and look at how much it cost them to write even a single Holy Bible back, in the 1400s and the 1500s. It took tremendous financial resources back then. And so take now, why it back to 2500 BC. How much effort did it take? How much expense did it take for them to record the ancient writings that they wrote back then? And why in the world would they write fiction if it was so expensive, which it was? Come on, folks. The common sense, I just utterly, so, we know what it is. It's a cover up. It's a massive, massive cover up from the forces of darkness. This notion, this dynamic that's been in existence for thousands of years to cover up a lot of the ancient histories and things that are obvious when you look at the facts and figures of around the archaeological, tangible evidence that's out there. When you look at this stuff, there obviously there's this ma there has been historically a massive cover-up. Anybody who's in the science profession understands that you either stay within their little playpen of acceptable information and write your thesis within that little playpen, or they're going to destroy you. It's all just it's no different in the science community and in the community than it is with a 13, 14-year-old girls in a lunchroom cafeteria in junior high and high school. It's no different. If you don't play in their playpen, if you don't play their game the way they want you to play it, you are ostracized. And that same dynamic occurs in the scientific community. And then you have these rebels that go out and write amazing books, like the book that I have behind me here, the Sirius Mystery, by Robert. Oh gosh, I forget his last name. I don't have the book. Actually, the book is downstairs. I was reading through it the other day. It's downstairs. And but anyway, the point is, it becomes so phenomenally obvious that there is arguably thousands of years, if not tens of thousands of years, if not hundreds of thousands, millions of years of time, maybe billions of years of time that is out there. It's tangible. It's scientific. It's written about. It's written about on multiple parts of the earth where there could not have been any collusion. There are scientifically verifiable archaeological artifacts that you cannot poo-poo away. The very existence of the Naxa lines, where you have to be up and basically at the level of the space shuttle to be able to clearly see that they were drawing animals and various other creatures on a very humongous large scale at the tip top of these mountain peaks, so that what? So the planes that flew overhead could see them? Oh, but when they did them, there wasn't any such thing as planes. Well, shucks, there goes that theory. The point of the matter is, folks, there is so much more to our existence, so much more to the universe than meets the eye. Praise Jesus. And that's what makes our existence as ultimately rising up as sons of God, as a royal priesthood, with the creator of all these things. It's not a nebulous new age creator. It's not a big, a supercomputer known as Landru that's hidden behind some kind of a secret wall in this underground facility that's running all of this. This isn't some big electronic computer contrived hologram. Yes, there's particle physics. Yes, it's in that sense of the word, there's a little bit of that, I suppose you could argue, going on. But in reality, which is the reality that we live in, the seen reality, in this reality that the Father wanted us to be a part of, that is the way that He creates His multiple realities in multiple dimensions, in glorious, humongous, fantastic universes with nebulas and quasars and black holes and without a doubt, portals and dimensions that can be traveled through if you understand these things, which these beings obviously do. They leverage these technologies. They leverage the electromagnetic plasma universe, as it were, and we get little bitty tastes of it. And when you understand that there are glorified beings out in the universe, that there are glorified parts of the universe, that Jesus was benevolent and loving and merciful enough to actually share that information with Pastor Howard Storm, and how many other people did Jesus share that information with that we're just not aware of yet? Probably a whole lot. Praise God. But thank you, Jesus, for at least hooking us up with Howard Storm and that radio show. What a blessing, man. It just brings tears to my eyes to realize the problem is that we either take one of two. Well, there's multiple positions you can take. Of course, the simple-mindedness position is, oh, it doesn't exist. It's all made up. That's easy for anybody to do. Just live in a little tiny cave and, you know, hey, my little campfire, my beanie weenies, and that's all I got. It's all I need. Me and my kids and our college tuition that we've been saving up for. But when you get the big picture, you know, Christianity, when they start to wake up to this, and I mean little C Christianity ultimately, but they either take, oh, well, you know, we're it, you know, we're the sons of God. We're the only race of, we're it. The earth is it. The whole, they even go sometimes as far as to suggest that the entire universe is just some hologram, some computer-created hologram, and we are it. Our pride in our hearts is so pervasive, so dominant. That element of pride in our DNA is so fabulously powerful. Ultimately, the very thing that caused Lucifer himself to fall. Me, 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 I. That's what took down the entire universe, ultimately. That's what took down this existence, this time-space, into a spiral downfall, entropy-driven collapse, into a fallen state. The pronoun I. And Christians go out there and they go, oh, well, you know, the earth, it's all about us because we got our Bible. And on our Bible, it says it's about us. It's just us. Us, 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 us. Even though that's really not the way the Bible reads. When you truly understand it, it's about us loving the other people on the earth enough to sacrifice our lives to bring them to Jesus. But yes, it is a roadmap for us to ultimately come and establish the relationship that we had with Jesus before the foundations of the earth, reestablish it to get back to our first estate, to take advantage of being raised up as a royal priesthood, and to understand how big that is. But there's a price to pay. Narrow is the path and difficult is the way. It means you've got to shun the things of the earth. You've got to become holy, distanced, and turned away from the darkness of the earth. You got to get yourself to the point where when you watch commercials about Viagra, they make you sick to your stomach. And you get up and you walk away, which is what I do now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We got to see how big this is. We got to understand how phenomenal this is. It just makes me cry. I can't believe it. I look at pictures of just the Smoky Mountains when they're at their glory around October, the end of October, when they're the leaves and the purple and the yellow and the orange, and you look at these incredible photographs at sunset, and you see the glory of God just as far as the eye can see, and the beauty and the color, and then you're like, oh my gosh. And he wants us to love him? Amidst the billions of universes, amidst the billions and trillions of stars, the billions and trillions of life forms, and all he asks for us is to love him. Yet, we're watching our TV shows and our Viagra commercials. When you come to this understanding, as heartbreaking as it is, ultimately what you discover is that he has, our Father, every right to take those who will not acknowledge him in his glory. and turned them away. And we've got to somehow do the best that we can, because it is our calling to wake people up and help them understand that it's not about I, and a little bitty earth and a Bible that was written just about us and everything else be damned. It's bigger than that. And the honor and the glory and the mercy of our Father and the sacrifice of Jesus hanging on that cross was so much more phenomenally intergalactic in its utter meaning, and who we are and who we're being called to be. Don't you see? It doesn't make us smaller because of the fact that all this stuff is real. It makes us that much more glorious before all of creation. That's the heartbreaking part of it. It's not just that we don't see the beautiful turning fall leaves in the Smoky Mountains. It's not just that. It's just knowing that what we know, instead of inspiring us, instead of encouraging us, instead of motivating us to become holy, to seek God with all of our heart, our mind, and our soul, with all of our being, because of the opportunity that he has laid before us, and all we have to do is turn ourselves away from this around us. How utterly, 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 utterly sad it is that probably 80%+ of the 7 billion people on this earth that have had the opportunity to even know about Jesus would throw it all away over their sex drive. Wow. Anyway, on that note, praise Jesus, the Peterson Chronicles, Angel Wars, the Luciferian Rebellion, show number 66. Woo! Hallelujah! I'm going to read this to you. This is very interesting. This is from the book UFOs, Aliens, Impregnated Women, Extraterrestrials, and God, Sex with Reptilians, Alien Motherhood in the Bible, Abductions, and Hybrids. And yes, it does say the Bible, and yes, there are major sections of this book that talk about the Bible, because you know why? You can't separate the cosmos from our existence. You can't separate the billions of years from our existence as sons of God here on this earth. Unfortunately, a lot of people try to do that. And they do it to the demise of those who are around them, who they have a ultimate responsibility to save. But that's okay. We've already covered that. Hallelujah. And on page 78, praise Jesus. Again, in this book, this is a really great work. Now, this particular individual, Maximilian de Lafayette, like so many other people who, I mean, you know, like Dave, the David Icke's of the world, the Maxwell, there's so many Jordan Maxwell's of the world. There's so many of these people who are, they see the devil, they see the satanic part of it, they don't see the Jesus part. How you can have the one without the other, I don't know. And then, okay, if you substitute in this creator God, this Landrew computer that's off on a distant planet as the creator, okay, and you just demote Jesus and you ultimately pave yourself a pathway directly to hell because you're unwilling to see that our God wants to have a relationship with us. If you're one of them, my heart hurts for you, and I mean that. I'm not just saying that. We have to understand that this is about us, but it's about us and everything else too, and to get everything in perspective. Praise God. But anyway, on this page, page 78, it talks about synthetics, and this is very fascinating. These are testimonies. This particular author dedicated his life. I pray in Jesus' name, Father God, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you move upon this particular author in the name of Jesus. Father, I want you to move upon all of them, but save the soul, Father God, in Jesus' name. As this earth shakes, I pray that you will save the soul of Maximilian de Lafayette, that you will reveal Jesus before him in all of his glory. In Jesus' name, I pray, amen. Now, praise God. So, this guy collected over thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands. This guy devoted his whole life to it, of testimonies of people who have been abducted. And if you've studied the abduction phenomenon with the number of years and fervor and investment that I have, this is not, it's not contrived, folks. It's humongous. It self-validates. It's very amazing. And out of those phenomenally large body of knowledge, these zillions of, I don't even know what the numbers are, but it's incredibly large numbers of testimonies. When you correlate it and you put it together in an organized manner, like the Lafayette has in multiple books, it tells a pretty scary story. And a scary story in the sense that these beings, for the most part, the ones that are dorking around with us here on the earth, are fallen, and they hate our guts. They want us destroyed. They're minions of Lucifer. They all work for, the devil. The glorified beings don't mess with us because they know about our Father. They live. It's so awesome. But these are the forces of darkness. Now listen to this, page 78. Synthetics. Of several different types and varieties, these synthetics are. Although reptilians and humans apparently utilize artificial intelligence devices or organisms, technology itself being amoral, neither good nor evil, the draconians, as well as some, quote, controlled humans, have apparently developed biosynthetic or mechanical entities as extensions of their activities. This is especially true of the biosynthetic cybernetic creatures, which the reptilians have allegedly created via organs stolen from animal and human mutilation victims. The synthetics are of many types, some of which are very human-like, and which may be used as infiltrators. Others apparently look more like the gray entities, created after their own image, so to speak, yet are not reptilian, but instead a type of molded entity form containing a sponge-like substance which permeates the interior. They may be the worst of all, as they are apparently biogenetic forms, which are able to be inhabited or possessed by infernals or fallen supernaturals as containers, enabling them to operate in the physical realm, possibly to the extent of performing the mutilations themselves, without the help of their reptilian allies, the draconians. It's fascinating that I'm reading this one particular section. I just watched the movie The Day the Earth Stood Still. And the being that ultimately took on a human form was encapsulated in basically a sponge-like substance which permeated the interior of his existence. And that sponge-like substance ultimately fell off of his body and had to be peeled away, and so that he was able to become birthed into some type of a human host body. Fascinating how these testimonies of people in this book, which is not even any longer in print, track back to so many of these science fiction movies that I'm sure somebody out there just has a really vivid imagination, and there's no rhyme or reason to how much it tracks back to the testimonies of all these thousands of people. Praise God. And on that note, let's go ahead and bring on Brother Kenneth and Brother Peterson. Praise Jesus. And we'll start out with the Charles Holler disclaimer.
Opinions of our guests are not necessarily those of Tribulation Now. TribulationNow.org, TribulationNow.net, TribulationNow.com, Facebook.com/TribulationNow. Or for that matter, heck, they may not be anyone else's opinions.
What?
So, be a good Berean, Acts 17:11, and search the scriptures daily to see if it is so. May God bless you.
Brother Kenneth, are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me, Johnny?
I can hear you from the distant ends of the cornfield where you worketh with your Amish brethren in the northwestern part of Pennsylvania. I'm kidding.
Yeah. We gotta bring in the corn.
Easton, Vernon, Gernon, Sternin.
Hey, I wanna just amen to what you said. You know, it is. I heard Ravi Zacharias say this, and I don't know if you've ever heard of him, but he's a convert from Hinduism, and he has traveled the globe 20 times over sharing the good news. And he has an incredible ministry now. He has lots of people out there just defending the faith and sharing the good news. But Ravi said this, and it kind of ties into what you said. He said that Christianity and the gospel of Jesus Christ is the only thing in this entire world that encompasses awe, mercy, justice, and love. And when you were talking, I could hear elements of all of those things. It is awe. You know, there's awe all about. And then the mercy that God had, but his mercy can never be doled out without justice on the other side. And Jesus bore that justice, and then we could come in by the spirit of adoption. When we're humble, and when we recognize that it's not us but him, and then sharing his love in this incredible creation that's beyond our imagination, as the angels stand in awe. Yet we have to come to that, not with the pride that Lucifer had, but with the humility that Jesus demonstrated. And only Christianity encompasses those four things. The awe of his creation in all of its glory. Not to even mention his glory revealed by John, you know, revealed to John in the book of Revelation. But just his created awe, you know, just the creation. And then that mercy and justice that have to work synonymously and together. And then what do we get? We get the love, like you said. And I heard you encompass all four elements of that in what you opened with, brother. And that is so true with nothing other than this good news that we share.
It's the eye problem. The eye problem seems to be the essence of all sin. The essence. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If we could take completely away, if we could summarize, and I'll, you know, in essence, in this statement, I will try to summarize it. If we could remove I and become part of the body of Jesus Christ, ultimately being invited in as a presence of the Godhead, that's really what this is all about. To be reunited with the Godhead as sons of God, a royal priesthood in the ages to come, for all of eternity, to be united supernaturally into the Godhead. And understand that Godhead is Jesus and our Heavenly Father, the creators of all things. If we could see it from the big picture and take the I and the me part out of it and look at all of creation, not just the beauty of the things that the beauty of the amazing things that we have here on the earth today that the Father created for us to be able to see his glory, to become closer to him. If we could see it without the I and the me in it, then everything would snap together and there would be so very little division out there.
Yep.
Because we would all
yep.
embrace the big picture. We would now all be seeing things from the throne room view. And when you see it from the throne room view, it's like, okay, tell me what to do. What is it in my life that you want me to get rid of? What is it that you want me to do here on this earth to be able to partake in that glory for all of eternity? There isn't a price that's too high to pay. When you see how big the reward is, when you see how big this mission is, there is nothing that's worth a dag nabbit here on this earth that isn't – I don't care what it is. Tell me what to do, Lord. You know what I mean? And you got these people out there, oh, I just can't. And I used to be one of them. I just can't imagine going through life without having sex. I'm like, boy, that's a pretty sad state of affairs. And there are people out there like that. Like I said, I used to be like that myself. You've got to break free of that. You've got to see the big picture. You've got to. And when you see it from that level, this existence is so infinitesimally all. It's just so unworthy of consideration. And the only thing that should matter is that we grab people and bring them with us.
There was a lady I used to minister with at my former church. Her name was Dawn, and her email address was itsallaboutjesus777. allaboutHim777@gmail.com. And I got that. I kind of mixed that up so she doesn't get emails and stuff, but you get the point. It's all about him. And when we get that, and you know who really got that is John, the one who rested his head on the bosom of Jesus Christ in the upper room. And he was so humble at the end of that. Remember, this was one of the sons of thunder that said, zap him, Lord. just dump napalm on them. So even John had to come through this sanctification process. But he got so humbled by the glory of Jesus revealed to him that when he wrote his gospel, he didn't even say, hey, I was the one that got to rest my head on his bosom. No, he didn't even say that. He just mentioned the one whom Jesus loves. You know, he didn't even mention it as himself. And then he goes on to give us such an incredible insight into how Jesus prayed. And Jesus prayed in John 17 that we're to become one with him as he's one with the Father. And how do we do that? We're to be sanctified by his word, which is truth. And then when he wrote his first letter to those in 1 John, he talks about the youth or the young in Christ. I should say the children in Christ, the youth, and then the fathers of the faith that pass it on. But the point I want to focus on right here for a minute is those young that are out there on fire serving the Lord. How did they get to that point where they were able to overcome the evil one? By the word of God living in them. Folks, that's the key here. We're sanctified by his word. His word is truth. We need to get that word buried in us. And so many Christians that I minister to on a weekly, daily basis, they don't read their Bibles. Folks, you got to get into his word. It's his love letter to you.
Yeah, praise God. Amen. And all we can do is just, you know, present this stuff and pray that people see the big picture. Because, you know, at the end of the day, it is exciting. I think it is exciting. And you know what makes it even more exciting is the existence of extraterrestrial races. It's the existence of the multiverses, arguably, the multiple dimensions that were shown to and told about by Jesus to Pastor Howard Storm. It's just amazing. As a matter of fact, on that note, let's go ahead and move ourselves back on topic. And I'm going to go ahead and share this little snippet, and then we're going to bring Brother Lauren on to blend it all right into the Luciferian Rebellion topic. Praise God. But this is Pastor Howard Storm talking about when he was taken to heaven after this big, big, long story, folks. But this is just a little bitty snippet of the part where he was, you know, taken to heaven and he was able to ask Jesus about extraterrestrials. Listen to this.
I asked them if there were other worlds, and they said, yeah, there's, the universe is full of other worlds, and there are other dimensions of other physical universes, and those are filled with other worlds. So there's worlds in our physical universe, there's unlimited number of worlds, inhabited worlds with intelligent beings, and then there are other dimensions with worlds with them. So, you know, beyond counting, beyond number, and that the action of God, the Word of God, the Son of God, the Christ, the Spirit of the Christ, has nothing is apart from that Spirit. And that Christ has been everywhere. Now, Jesus the Carpenter wasn't Jesus the Carpenter in every single one of these worlds, because in many of these worlds, our world is in the lower level of spiritual evolution, and in many of these worlds Jesus didn't have to go to a world and be crucified and die on a cross for their sins, because there are worlds where people have chosen good and rejected evil and lived a life profoundly in the love of God and in the love of their neighbor. And so Jesus could go to these worlds and just bless them and they were, you know, happily accepted Jesus. I mean, what a different, can you imagine a world where Jesus came and people said, yes, you know, we knew and understood this is what you wanted us to be, and we thank you for being our revelation, and we've known you from the beginning of time. We've known you and understood you and tried to live the way that you have, you know, wanted us to live. There are worlds where people are perfectly good and have no sin and don't allow evil to be part of their lives. This world is unique because of the degree of not only temptation but the willingness to accept temptation and failing the testing that we're in. When I asked to see what other intelligent beings look like, they paraded images of beings in front of me, and they started off as humans. And then they got a little stranger looking, and a little stranger looking, and then they became unrecognizable as human beings and looked very weird. And I said, okay, I get it. They can be, like, shaped in very different ways. Fine, whatever, you know, I get it. You know, I mean, in other words, they, there's worlds where people have this kind of shape, but there's worlds where people take on very different kinds of shapes. But the shape of us in this world is of little importance, because in fact, what's important is our spiritual being and who we ultimately truly are beings of light. We're beings of love. We are, in a sense, this tent that we live in now is not who we truly are. And in our immortal bodies, we're glorious. In this body, it's more like a little pup tent or prison that we're in.
Prison. Just like the Cathars, they knew. Praise God. And now we'll bring on Lauren. Brother Lauren, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Hey,
that's
Brother Lauren.
Yeah.
Hello, hello.
How's it going?
Hey, could I jump in here before Brother Lauren takes off and just comment on what Howard Storm said?
Yeah.
Hey, I mentioned this, and I'm a guy that just loves to read anything, get my hands on, and I've found that C.S. Lewis is really on top of it all. And I think he had to fictionalize a lot of stuff because people just wouldn't receive it. But he basically said what Howard Storm just said there in his book, his first two books out of the space trilogy, Out of the Silent Planet and Paralandra. There are other nations or other worlds or other peoples that have never had the same fall that we have and have never known a time or a life without fellowship with the Lord. And you know, whether this is true or not, there's some people that are very godly that have had this inkling. There's Howard Storm, there's C.S. Lewis, and when I heard Storm speak in there, it was paralleling directly the story of Paralandra. That was
pretty
interesting.
You want to know what else it parallels? Which is just it's stupefying. The work by John W. Myler.
That's true. Yeah.
Yep.
Yes.
And Aliens and the Antichrist. I don't know if Myler, I mean, we've had him on the radio show more than once, and I don't know if Myler was visited in his dreams. Maybe C.S. Lewis was visited in his dreams. I don't know. We don't know how these people get this stuff in their heads. But John W. Myler does a fabulous job of paralleling the scripture against basically the essence of what Howard Storm was just saying. And I'm like, oh my gosh, where do these people see, how do these people see this stuff? Glorified planets, glorified beings. I mean, holy mackerel.
You're going to find this kind of interesting. C.S. Lewis reveals some of that in some of his more biographic type writings, and you can find that in this book. It's just a compendium called God in the Dock, and then there's also the one that his biography is, and I forget the title of it. Folks, if you're really that interested, email me and I'll get you the name. It's in my library. But he says that he has found most of his from reading the ancient writings. He is a literary scholar. So I know C.S. Lewis got it out of a lot of ancient writings. And he said those fairies and all those different stories of giants and that aren't stories. So I know where C.S. Lewis got a lot of his from, but, man, we got to take heed here and listen to these folks.
Oh, yeah. We're so busy grabbing our pitchforks and lighting torches and chasing down every Christian that has that is able to see spiritually and sense the magnitude of God's glory. We hunt them down and kill them, for heaven forbid that they should think outside of the tiny little thimble on the table. Anyway, thank you, Jesus. Anyway, Brother Lauren, how's it going down in there? What are you at, level 120 of the missile silo bunker?
Yeah, and going deeper every day, going deeper.
Keep on digging, brother. Keep on digging.
Yeah, keep on digging.
Yeah, until you hear Chinese.
Yeah, that's right. I better take some Chinese lessons.
Yeah, and a little bit of, I don't know, Egg Foo Young, too. I hear they're hungry sometimes. Yeah.
Well, I already like Chinese foods, you know, and noodles and things, so.
Good. You'll be all set.
You bet.
And in case you're a little bit off course, you might want to bring a little bit of Thai seasoning along, you know.
All right.
Praise God.
Yeah, and that's coming from a Norwegian. That eats lutefisk and lepsa.
Oh, no, now you're sounding Amish. All right.
Well, the show's already got me fired up, okay? So, so under the traditional model, the Christian traditional model is that when Adam and Eve sinned, they paint it that not only did the planet come under sin, but the entire creation fell into sin, okay? Now, at least that's been my understanding of the traditional model, that when Adam and Eve sinned, the entire creation fell into sin. And that didn't, as my life went on and I started reading some of these books, you know, from 75 onward, it became apparent that was not the case, you know, because you end up with these questions, you read these books, some are Christian authors, some are secular authors, and it became very apparent that if Lucifer, if we take, you know, we know from Revelation chapter 12 that one-third of the angelics or life forms, that he succeeded in getting them to rebel and war along with him against the Godhead, all right? So I use that one-third figure as a general kind of rule of thumb, general illustration that one-third of the original creation fell into this mother of all black holes. And a mother of all black holes can also be looked at as when you go from the original creation where everybody and everything is on track, and then you enter in when Lucifer turned away and he walked away, that began the process of the phase shift. As what he did was reflected into the physicalities of God's creation, okay? We can say that was the beginning of the phase shift away from God's original creation, a phase shift into an altered reality, which ultimately created the mother of all black holes, the fallen one-third of creation. So if you begin to understand that at that simple level, then you can understand if one-third fell, that means that two-thirds remained unfallen.
Right, and so, there is something else to consider, and I'm going to be quiet after this, but just to throw it over the tabletop.
Okay.
We don't have the scope defined in the Bible. So when the word creation is used, we assume that it includes the other dimensions.
That's right.
So when you make a probably an appropriate assumption that the scope of what the Bible is talking about is a limited scope, one-third of that limited scope is even a smaller chunk of the overall, right? So
yeah.
I'm just pointing that out because that really opens up the possibilities on a grand scale.
Yeah. And again, the traditional model is basically a flat model of creation, like just one universe, you know, just a flat model universe. And that's it. One universe, one dimension, one creation. That's it. Okay. That's the traditional model. Okay. So again, the Lord began to show me about the fallen one-third versus that means then that there was an unfallen two-thirds. And then later in the latter 90s, turn of the century, he began to show me right here on our own planet. We've got several dimensions right here in our own physicality. There's water, there's air, there's land, there's outer space, four different dimensions right within our own 3D physicality, okay? But we don't regard that as three, four separate dimensions, okay, of existence. We just regard that as our world or our solar system, okay? We don't break it down. So again, even scientifically, we tend to look at things in a flat model rather than a multi-dimensional, multiverse model. Now, more scientists are more and more getting on board a multiverse way of looking at things and a multi-dimensional because the more they look into these things, the more they realize that it's just not a flat model anymore. A flat model doesn't answer all these enigmas that they're coming up with, all these question marks, and trying to figure things out. They keep coming up with more questions, and the old traditional flat model reality just doesn't work anymore. It's fine when you're starting out. It's like learning to ride a bicycle. You put training wheels on. Those training wheels are fine when you're learning how to ride a bicycle, but the point comes when you don't need them anymore. And in fact, if you continue to use them, they will hamper your progress. Okay, they will hamper your progress in mastering the bicycle. So you eventually take them off and you never put them back on. And so once you start to understand and get on board multiverses and multiple dimensions within multiple universes and smorgasbord of life forms everywhere, just like what Jesus showed Pastor Howard Storm, it's a huge, huge bingo. Okay, it's like, how could it be any other way? You know, you can, like you've been saying repeatedly, you can't put, you know, We tend to, but you can't really put God in the 12-ounce soda can. And yet so many people do that. Okay, so it's from the traditional perspective, it's difficult for us to imagine worlds out there somewhere, worlds out there that never fell to sin. Because, again, getting back to what you were saying earlier today is us. This is the only planet that has life on, and every place else out there is just a dead rock floating in space. You know, it's all about us. No, it's not all about us. There are worlds out there that never fell to sin, never fell to this Luciferian rebellion. They stayed true to the one true God. And imagine what kind of a society, what kind of a culture, what kind of technologies those various peoples have that have continued from the very beginning of their creation, when God created them, that they have never deviated from his plan, his original plan, his original destinies for those peoples. They never deviated. Imagine the blessings they get to enjoy unhindered. You know, it's difficult for us on this planet, on this reality, to imagine such a thing. And so being myopic that we are, and myopia comes from sin, okay? Because sin is from I, me, you know, us, looking at me, okay? We become myopic and we don't consider other people. We don't consider our interaction with other people because the world revolves around me, okay? I'm so important and you're nothing, okay? That kind of attitude. And so it's difficult because this whole planet is engulfed in sin. It's difficult for us to imagine, even us as Christians, to imagine that there could be worlds out there that never fell. But again, it comes down to this one-third, two-thirds. The two-thirds of creation, and that creation involves multiverses and multiple dimensions and smorgasbord of life forms that never fell to Lucifer's rebellion and war in the heavens. All right, so that once you get your mind around that, it opens up. That alone will open up scriptures to whole new levels of understanding of things. And this fallen one-third, this mother of all black holes, this has God put an expiration date on it so that it cannot continue on. This fallen one-third cannot continue on indefinitely forever, because that would end up becoming a contradiction to who God is himself. You know, if there is truly justice and righteousness and holiness to our Heavenly Father, then he cannot allow this fallen one-third existence to continue indefinitely forever, because there would be in direct conflict, contradiction to his very nature and to his word, okay, and everything, okay. So there's an expiration date to this fallen one-third, but again, this fallen one-third, we view this as our universe, our existence. We view our side of things as matter, M-A-T-T-E-R, when in fact we are the antimatter side of the coin. And the unfallen two-thirds are the matter side, and we are the antimatter. Okay, we are the anti-matter, the anti-God side. The fallen one-third is the anti-God, anti-matter side, the mother of all black holes. And picture black holes as time progressed from that point of deviation. Okay, point of deviation as time progressed from that the altered frequencies became more and more altered, and then you end up with black holes within black holes within black holes, okay, within black holes, an endless treadmill of this type of outcome, okay, the closed loop reality, where we are condemned to repeat history. You can learn about history as much as you want. Everybody on the planet, theoretically, if we could teach everybody on the planet an equal understanding of history under the theory that once everybody understood the fullness of history, then nobody would even be tempted to repeat it. I'm sorry, folks. Mankind, ever since Adam and Eve partook of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, has been condemned to repeat history, because that's what sin does. It causes people and entities to repeat and to not be able to get off that treadmill. And so the only solution, the only way out of this enigma is through Jesus Christ. He's the only way out of this fallen one-third. And the story of the Exodus story in the book of Exodus is reflective of that reality, where the Hebrews left Egypt and Moses led them through and crossed over the Red Sea there. And the sea parted so they could cross over dry land. And once they were all over on the other side, and this is not just like a handful or two of people that crossed the Red Sea, folks. This is quite a lot of people that had to cross over, and that included wagons and donkeys and cattle and sheep and you know, it was a whole lot of life forms that had to cross over there. But once they were all safely all over on the other side, and the Egyptians thought, oh, well, we can cross over there too, God caused that sea to come back together and flooded them all out, killed them all. And so Jesus is offering that dry land to each one of us in him, through him, to be able to cross safely to the other side. And once we are there, when this expiration date finally kicks in, that's when the floodwaters come crashing back in and flood out all the unrighteous. Okay? So picture this mother of all black holes, like floodwaters, ultimately consuming itself, eating itself alive. That's one way of looking at it, okay? I don't know if that would be the reality of what would happen, but it's just one way of looking at it. That ultimately it will consume itself. Sin ultimately consumes itself. Jesus gives us his life when we accept him into our life. Then we exchange our death sentence for his life eternal. All right, so I want to touch on a few topics here before I get into the Syrians that are very interesting. Now, last time Ken, you made mention of what about the cavemen and cavewomen and hunter-gatherer theory of evolution, okay? So I touched upon, like, the Tower of Babel. But I want to just touch upon, again, another aspect of the Tower of Babel. Imagine, like, today, we have what in times past today would be considered a super civilization. And if our society, if our world civilization is allowed to continue, if it were allowed to continue on, we would definitely enter into the Genesis 11, verse 6, reality. And perhaps we are already there in the deep laboratories around the world, unlocking the secrets of the universe, where just about anything and everything is possible for mankind to do. Revisiting verse 6, Genesis chapter 11. That's the key to understanding the Tower of Babel, that they weren't a bunch of primitive nomads out in the middle of nowhere building a clay tower to study the stars above. That's what the powers that be would like us to think, according to the theory of evolution. Okay, but evolution is a bunch of rubbish. Once you understand that mankind was created at 100% DNA activation. Now, I used the 12-stranded. That's what the New Agers believe in. And it seems plausible, it seems reasonable to me that Adam and Eve would be created with 12 strands. But whether they were created with 12 strands or with only two, the point is they were at 100% activation, and now we're down to 8%. Does that sound like evolution to anybody? Okay. To me, that sounds like we've fallen almost flat on our faces over these thousands of years. That's what sin does. That's what this endless loop reality, this closed loop reality of from that tree of good and evil, the knowledge of good and evil, produces, is mankind starting at 100% and devolving to 8%. And Jesus realistically said that unless those days be cut short, no flesh would be saved. He knew that if mankind were to go through another worldwide cataclysmic event, mankind would become an extinct species. All right, so picture, if we were able, okay, so picture our two strands at 8% being stripped down to one strand at 2 to 4% activation. Do you think anybody would even be able to procreate? The correct answer would be no. We would not, mankind as a race would not, as a human race would not be able to even procreate to sustain the species. So we would fast end up in extinction just like the dinosaurs. But we are not dinosaurs. The dinosaurs were not created in God's exact image and likeness, but we were. Jesus did not come to die on that cross for the dinosaurs' salvation. He came and died on the cross for our salvation. That's the difference. But let's say, for example, that, you know, another world cataclysm, World War III happens, the world erupts in nuclear holocaust, and all these volcanoes go off and everything, and we're able to survive as a species, but society collapses. All the technologies that we have at our disposal, they're already telling us that if EMPs go off above our nation, electromagnetic pulse, it will turn the United States within a nanosecond or something back to the 1800s. And within 1 year, something like 90% of the population of the United States will perish because hardly anybody knows anymore how to live like we used to live in the 1800s. We've become so accustomed to our modern conveniences that few of us would be able to survive as we used to do in the 1800s. Okay, I'm included in that group, folks. I'm really kind of I enjoy modern conveniences. I can somewhat imagine living in the 1800s, but I tell you, it would be very difficult to make that transition. Even if just the way that we live in cities, towns, you know, with these small lots we live on, in order to feed a family, you have to have, like, I don't know, 2-3 lots worth of land to have a garden space and animals, you know, chickens, whatever, to be able to survive. And you have to have wood. And look back in the 1800s, they basically had to have a cooking wood stove going almost 24/7. Well, certainly during the day, you know, before daybreak, you fire that stove back up and it's going for the rest of the day and into the night until the embers die down during the night. And then you have to start it up again. So during the daylight hours, you're running that stove almost constantly because you have to be cooking constantly, cooking and baking to feed everybody. And think about the clothes you used to wear back in the 1800s. The women, for example. Now, I know today, you know, we wear a whole lot less clothes than people in the 1800s did. So, you know, that's up for debate on what people would be wearing this time around. But the point is, we'd have to be running that cook stoves. There'd be no air conditioning. So it heats up in the house just by, you know, the heat on the outside from the sun and everything. And then you're running that cook stove. It'd be like boiling water inside the house. You know, you're just, sweat is just pouring out of you all day long and all night long. So that's just one of the factors. Okay, so, but picture everything just falling apart. Cars, planes, all of our technology is just not working anymore. And over the, you know, so a lot of people, cities are nuked, and so you can't go back in the city, you can't go back to the house because it's now atomized rubble, you know, dust, nuclearized dust. So where are you going to go? You're going to go in forests, you're going to go into caves. You're going to revert, not just to 1800. That's if you're fortunate enough to still have a house and still be able to live off the land in 1800s existence. But for those of us who don't have that luxury, we would end up reverting back to caves and open terrains and forests and scavenging for whatever morsels of food we could. And our clothes that we take for granted today would eventually wear out, and we would have to go back to killing animals. Yes, killing animals or some other means of having some kind of clothes to survive the environments. Go ahead.
Brother Long, can I jump in here?
Yeah.
You're painting a beautiful scenario of, quote-unquote, the caveman, and picking up a line from von Daniken in some of his books. Now, he wasn't a believer, but he postulated a very interesting scenario. After the cataclysms, and there were many, we know some, Noah, you know, and the great flood. We know what happened at Sodom and Gomorrah. We know when the sun stood still with Jeremiah. There were these periods of cataclysm, and everything civilized was wiped out, and people had to start back, like you said. So the current thought among anthropologists and archaeologists and historians is that that's how we began. Perhaps that's how we recovered after one of these cataclysms.
That's right. And so this idea, this notion of evolution, that man evolved from cavemen, you know, and cave women, and carrying clubs and beating animals to death for their skins and their meat and everything. Well, that was after the collapse. Imagine the Tower of Babel, global civilization, high tech, high society. Genesis 11, verse 6, that kind of reality on a global scale, totally collapsing. Because when God came down to destroy the tower, he destroyed the technologies and the basis for those technologies and confused that one world language into multiple languages and spread everybody all over the place. And there's a guy named Peleg that you mentioned many episodes ago, but it's right there in the Bible account, Peleg, and that's when the land was divided. So the implications there is some serious landmass changes, some serious earth changes, folks, like earthquakes and supercontinental drift. Areas that were above land now below the ocean, areas that were below the ocean now above the ocean becoming new land, you know, just all kinds of topsy-turvy things going on as a consequence of the Tower of Babel. Remember, the Tower of Babel was not a clay tower to study the stars and constellations. It was a super high-tech device capable or technology basis to not just open a portal. There are many portals throughout creation, portals, doorways, from one dimension to another, from one universe to another. Just like in a mansion, there are many doors and doorways within a mansion or within our own homes, many doors and doorways that we go from one room to the other. So it's just like that in looking at multiple dimensions and multiple universe, there's a gazillion doors and doorways to go between all these various realms. And so when you're talking about the Tower of Babel, it's not just going from a portal here in our solar system, maybe over to the Sirian system, for example. Okay, Stargate technologies, you know, just dial up the star, power up the Stargate device and just walk right over into that Stargate over in Sirius A and talk with the Nomos, you know, talk a while with the Nomos and then come back here. A nice, pleasant Sunday afternoon chit-chat with some Nomos and then beam right back here. now, what this Tower of Babel, for God to be so concerned that he would have to come down and destroy that technology and all the technologies associated with it and to reduce mankind back to a caveman existence, back to a Stone Age existence, means that that technology threatened him. That technology was so advanced that it could open the ultimate portal into the Holy of Holies itself. That's my opinion, and that's why God came down to destroy it, because that's how powerful that technology was. You don't get that kind of powerful technology by being a bunch of nomads, being a bunch of cavemen. The cavemen, the nomads, came as a result of that high-tech global society being reduced, being stripped, being destroyed. Global catastrophe. And now they have to revert to living in caves and forests and open plains, revert to wearing skins, okay, that kind of thing. This super high-tech civilization totally devastated. That's my opinion on what happened. You don't find that level of sophistication, that level of power in the Sumerians. I've been reading Sitchin's book, The 12th Planet, and the Sumerians were very, very advanced. It's just amazing to read about them, that the only difference between them and us today is the level of technology. But they were basically doing the same things we do today, laws and rules and regulations and how to set up, you know, plumbing and streets and architectures and everything. It was just amazing how similar it is. The only difference that I see is the level of technology. But you don't find Genesis 11, in my opinion, Genesis 11, verse 6, within anywhere within the Sumerian civilization, that level of power and sophistication, nor the Babylonian, the kingdom of Babylon. So in my opinion, that means that it happened way before those Sumerians.
Hey, Brother Lauren, can I jump in again here?
Yeah.
You just triggered something in me, and I'm going to stay focused on what we're talking about and not jump back to the scriptures so much like I love to do. But, you know, thinking about what you said, and in Genesis 4, again, I'm using it historically like, you know, Lafayette did, because you have to get back to it. But Genesis 4 gives us a very good history of the baddies who brought in things like metalworking, music, the arts. But one thing was lacking in all that, and you used the generic term technology. I'm going to kind of modify a little bit and say electronic technology. And electricity.
Yep.
And then let's wind the clock ahead to Tesla and some of the stuff like in his White Dove book written by some woman, I forgot her name, where he was visited. Could he have been visited by some of the same class that visited these folks back in Genesis 4 and gave the baddies the arts, so to speak, and metalworking and all that, where they were very advanced?
Yep.
And then that one didn't give them the electronics until Tesla came along, because much of what we have today came from Tesla. And he admits that he communicated. So, wow, that was very interesting what you said, and it kind of parallels some things we see in the story of Tesla. And that's when we had this explosion of what you called technology.
Yeah. Amen. So that level of capability, we are regaining that verse 6 level once again. the rebirth of the Tower of Babel technologies, tower technologies, is taking place right in front of our noses. And yet, because we've been deceived by the theory of evolution, and we've been deceived by the traditional teaching of the church understanding of creation and how that moved forward, Adam and Eve moving forward, and the traditional explanation of the pre-flood world and then the pre-Tower of Babel world, we have, traditionally speaking, we have no clue of the high-tech global civilizations that existed at the Tower of Babel and then even more so prior to the flood. So you picture Adam and Eve, whether a 2-strand or 12-strand, but at 100% activation. After they sin, it's down to a 90-plus percent. At that level, okay, picture yourself at, let's say we're at 10% and not 8. Okay, so 10% times 9 would be 90%. Can you picture having 9 times more power in your mind? that's difficult to imagine that. Because we're so used to our current paradigm, our current existence, that we just assume that that's how it was back then. But if we can wrap our minds around that Adam and Eve started at that high level, and even after they sinned, they passed a 90-plus percent capacity onto their descendants, and now you back the watchers that came down with their DNA matrix, okay, piggybacked onto mankind's DNA to create the giants. So now you have mankind, supercharged. It's a combination of human DNA and watcher DNA creating this giants, okay? Both giants, I believe, in physical stature, but also in mental and soul capacity, soul power capacity. They were even more powerful than what mankind was, even mankind at 90-plus percent capacity. It, I guess you could say it's all relative, you know. To us, if we could be at 90% capacity, we would think we had arrived in heaven, okay? But we'd still be in a fallen state. But we would think we would have arrived at heaven. But if everybody on the planet here had 90% capacity, we'd be about, relatively speaking, the same as we are today at 8%. We might have a different expression of technologies, a different way of building buildings and expressing our technologies and our scientific achievements. But if somebody at 90%, you know, today we think, oh, if I only had 90%, I could rule the world. Well, not if everybody else had 90% capacity. You wouldn't be ruling anybody except yourself, you know, because everybody else would be at 90%. So it's all relative. So you can see when these watchers came down and intermixed their DNA with mankind's DNA, creating these giants with a supercharged DNA, now they were the game changer. These giants were the game changer for mankind. Now they ended up ruling over mankind because they had the powers even greater than mankind. So us today, even if we're at 10%, imagining what 90% would be like, thinking we'd be so awesome and powerful and godly-like, you know, but no, we wouldn't, because there'd still be that problem with those watchers out there intermingling their DNA with our DNA, creating giants that would be even more powerful than we at 90% would be. Okay? So it's kind of like in the advanced martial arts, you learn that to be humble. If you go around in martial arts with an attitude, there's going to be somebody who's going to kick your butt right at the curb. Okay, kick your butt out to the curb and in the gutter, and you're done. You know. So the ideal behind martial arts is you have a humble attitude about the things that you've learned and mastered. And so the masters understand that there's always going to be somebody who's more powerful and more capable than even themselves. And so they remain humble to that fact. And they're in their humility then, is what helps them gain their mastery over somebody who is more powerful. Because typically, somebody who's more powerful is more arrogant. And so the masters know how to take that arrogance from their opponent and turn that around to a victory for the master, if that makes sense, folks. Just like David versus Goliath. Okay, in the natural realm, there was absolutely no way David could have won against Goliath. Goliath was so much taller, so much more, physically powerful, and David was this little shrimp. Okay, he's basically a teenager, but physically he was also kind of like what we would say today as a shrimp. And he had absolutely no military training. He was just this shepherd boy on the backside of the mountains, tending the sheep. So what did he know about warfare? What did he know about these giants and Goliath, how to go up against them, successfully defeat them? Okay, well, he didn't have to know anything. All he had to have was God. And he was able to defeat Goliath with one blow to Goliath's head with that slingshot and a rock. Okay, so David wielded a low technology against Goliath in his super stature and his high technology. David was able to defeat Goliath with a low-tech solution because God was in that low-tech solution. Okay, so that's another way of looking at humility versus arrogance. Goliath was arrogant. David was humble. God will work through our humility in whatever giants that exist in our life, now and to come. If we remain humble before our Lord and before mankind, God will work through our humility to bring down those giants. I hope that makes sense. Okay, so it's my opinion that as a collapse, the Tower of Babel, a global society, it all collapsed. God came down, declared war, okay, that kind of thing. And mankind being mankind, it's not out of the realm of possibility that mankind itself erupted in war against each other as well. But in any event, you come up with a global collapse and mankind reverting, the survivors reverting to living in caves, living in forests, living out in the open. And if there were any structures that survived, like pyramids or anything, they might have sought refuge. If there was any way to get inside for refuge, for safety, they might have gone into there. We know about deep underground caves and caverns and tunnels and things like that. So there might have been chunks, portions of mankind here and there, just like today, digging these deep underground bases and interconnected deep underground with all these tunnels, going from point A to point B to Z on these super trains. So mankind already on a global scale is digging deep into the ground, creating these areas of refuge to protect themselves from what the calamities that are to come, as predicted in the Bible. And so it's highly plausible that mankind did that back then, and that some of mankind then took refuge within the caves within the deep areas of the earth. And then after these cataclysms passed, they reemerged. All right, so here's an interesting tidbit article. Single DNA molecule could store information for a million years following scientific breakthrough. DNA molecule. Just one DNA molecule could store information for a million years. Okay, so the scientists are figuring this out, folks, what God originally designed our DNA to be, a depository. DNA is not just concerning our life, me, I kind of thing. The DNA that I inherited encompasses the information that goes all the way back to Adam and Eve, theoretically. Carries that information forward through thousands of years of history and cataclysms to this point today. Now, again, we're at 8% activation, so that other 92%, if we could reactivate some of that, would we also regain some of our ancient memories from former times that are encoded upon within our own DNA? That's something to think about. So they They say that this breakthrough could lead to digital archives of everything from ancient texts to Wikipedia changes being stored in a form of DNA that could, in theory, survive for hundreds of thousands of years without any loss of data. Okay, think about that for a while, folks, how God designed our original DNA to be able to store information for hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of years of time, the capacity to do that. Okay, now another article, if I can pull it up here, is about sleeping giants. And let's see. Sleeping giants in stasis chambers ready to awaken, whistleblower claims. Some of you have already read this. And Steve Quayle has deep dived for like 20, 30 or so years, has deep dived into giants. And that's been one of his things, you know, to bring forward into public disclosure. And I have not read any of his information directly, any of his books about giants, but I can well imagine the depth that he's dug into. So even though I have not read his books, I would highly recommend, if you're interested in deep diving into giants, to read up on in his books. Okay, so here there's a Mr. Godey makes some startling claims about sleeping giants located in stasis chambers hidden all around the world. He says that during his downtime in a secret space program assignments, so there's that secret space program stuff again popping up. Okay, he would review information on smart glass pads. The pads were like a Wikipedia-like repository of information that personnel in the Solar Warden and other secret space programs could access about various aspects of ancient Earth history, extraterrestrial life, advanced technologies, etc. Godey described seeing information about giants that once lived on Earth, now sleeping in stasis chambers. My goodness, folks. Here's some giants in these sleeping stasis chambers all over the world. Here's this secret space program that's deep diving into everything from A to Z to try to get an upper hand on this stuff. And here we are still, people still, you know, believing in evolution or believing in the traditional story of the creation account. And here's all this advanced stuff, these people on the cutting edge of deep diving into this stuff from A to Z, discovering all this stuff. How in the world, even if they were to come clean with the rest of the world, how in the world would they make any kind of touch base with any kind of rationality to most people? Okay, so if you're somebody who's grabbed on to the theory of evolution, this is going to totally blow you away. If you've or a Christian, you've totally grabbed on to the creationist theory of creation, that everything was created 6,000 years ago, you're going to be blown away by this information. You're going to have no point of reference, no point of being able to connect with this information. That's just all the devil. You're going to be in denial. Whether you believe in the theory of evolution or you believe in the theory of creationism, you're going to just be in total denial. So these people that are deep diving in this stuff on the cutting edge, it's like they are also in a conundrum, because how do you explain this stuff to regular people? How do you bring it out to make sense? Well, one of the ways that we discuss in this program, Tribulation Now, is through science fiction movies and TV programs, through the power of suggestion, through the power of possibility. Even here, as we discuss the Chronicles, we're looking at, you know, the Angel Wars overlay on the creation account and how that plays out as a very distinct possibility on how things really did happen rather than the traditional approach to how it happened, okay? So when the powers that be, they're trying to present this information through these various movies and TV programs, as well as prophetic announcements of, like through disaster movies, on what's coming up. We can read it right there in the Bible, but most people in the world don't read the Bible. But most people will go to a movie, but they won't read the Bible. So even God will work through what the powers that be put forth in their movies and TV programs and books and magazine articles about this kind of stuff. You know, if we're paying attention, we'll see the hand of God in this stuff. And the Holy Spirit will quicken. Bingo. There's a bingo right there. You see that bingo? Okay. All right. Now, I want to tie these glass stasis pods. Yeah. Yeah. Are you trying to talk, Ken? Okay. Just jump in whenever you want to here, anybody. Okay, so these giants, sleeping giants, okay, now let's picture, for example. I wrote this down this morning. Okay, this triune Sirian system, 8.7 light years away from our system. Okay, they have admitted the Sirian High Council, these beings that ascended from the three-dimensional existence into a six-dimensional existence. Okay, they're channeling through this lady, Patricia Corey, and they're admitting some things, but they're kind of like sugarcoating it, you know, trying to sugarcoat some stuff so it sounds better than what it was. Okay, which is a form of deception, dangling a carrot like they're here to help us in our ascension. You mean you're here to help us go through our wars and end up like you in a sixth dimension? I want to remind everybody that within this fallen one-third are most likely nine dimensions. And the ninth dimension is the Luciferian dimension, where if you ascend to the ninth dimension, you become one with Lucifer. Isn't that a grand, reality? But that fallen one-third has the expiration date attached to it. It will not exist forever. It will be brought to a final judgment. So even if anybody would be fortunate enough, and I say that sarcastically, to defer final judgment from this three-dimensional existence to be able to ascend to our Sirian brothers and sisters into the sixth dimension, you're still going to have to face final judgment, just like they are, just like Lucifer in the ninth dimension and all his cronies up there in the ninth dimension. All nine dimensions are going to face final judgment. It has an expiration date. Okay? So you might think, oh, good, I can ascend to the sixth dimension, hang out with Ethereans and other groups and stuff, you know, but you're still going to be brought into final judgment. There's no way around it, okay? No way to get around that final judgment. Now, picture, okay, this angel wars also erupted in this triune Sirian system. The angel wars took out Sirius B and its planets, leaving Sirius B as a 3D white dwarf and obliterating all of its planets and their life forms, and the inhabitants of Sirius B's planets ascended into the sixth dimension, making themselves known to us as the Sirian High Council, existing now in their light bodies. That would tell me soul bodies, no longer physical bodies, but soul bodies, because their flesh bodies were consumed, obliterated during the angel wars that ravaged the triune Sirian system. Quoting, it travels, this is Sadius, Sirius B, travels in an elliptical orbit around Sirius A, which it completes in a 50-year cycle. I don't know if that 50-year cycle has any connection with the 50-year cycle of the Master Jubilee year. Okay, so you have like every seventh year is a Jubilee year, and then 7 times 7 would be 49, and then the next year, the 50th year, is the Master Jubilee Year. I have no idea if there's a connection. Sometimes you can have a correlation, but a correlation does not mean cause and effect. There could be something else operating at a different level, a deeper level, that is causing the correlation than what we see in the correlation. Hope that makes sense. Okay, Anu. This is Sirius C. Anu. The Angel Wars also took out Sirius C, known as Anu, and most of its planets, leaving Sirius C as a 3D brown dwarf, a.k.a. the Black Sun, and hurtling the only surviving planet, Nibiru, and its inhabitants, the Anunnaki, a warrior-class type of beings, like the Klingons of Star Trek fame, out into the darkness of space. The astrophysicists on that planet attempted to calculate a possible trajectory and possible destination, but early on it was impossible until they finally entered into our own solar system and were captured by our sun. The Anunnaki scanned this new solar system, scanned it with their technologies, and finding Earth inhabitable, sent down landing parties, which also took up residence upon the Earth, as Nibiru was flung back out into space, leaving the Earthbound Anunnaki behind. It took 1,800 Earth years for Nibiru to reach our solar system, and unknown to the Anunnaki at that time, it would take another 1,800 Earth years for Nibiru to slingshot back to their point of origin, back to the Sirian area that they originated from. Kind of like eels and salmon returning to their point of origin, their point of birth, Nibiru, and whatever is associated with it, any other planets, maybe even the dwarf brown star, are all connected and heading right back to the Sirian point of origin. So now, Nibiru has since made round trips of 3,600 Earth years between their point of origin and our solar system since that point, that original point. So, if they have this type of high-tech capability, the Anunnaki, and if they sent down landing parties, and as those landing parties realize that, hey, you know, our planet is heading back out into space somewhere, so we have to kind of make do here, they would have brought their technologies with them, the landing parties, some kind of technologies. And maybe on subsequent returns to Earth, okay, what I'm trying to connect with is these giants in stasis chambers are connected with Nibiru, with the Anunnaki. Okay? And possibly, you know, again, on this Nibiru planet, picture Earth being dislodged from its location and being hurled out into space. And if there was anybody that would survive that, you know, anybody, and especially scientists, would come up with artificial lighting schemes, and certainly those scientists involved in the deep underground bases already have come up with artificial lighting schemes and energy-producing schemes to be able to withstand the coming calamities that are coming upon the Earth. So if our scientists can come up with these technologies, and you can very well believe that the scientists of the Anunnaki also came up with their technologies to have some kind of artificial lighting scheme on their planet Nibiru as it was hurling through space. And then when it finally became apparent that it was became a symbiotic relationship of coming here to our solar system, then slingshotting back to their former place, and then slingshotting back and forth like this, it becomes a repeatable occurrence, a repeatable situation. So now they come back here 3,600 years to see if anybody of their landing party is still here. All right. So in that 3,600 years time, the Anunnaki have probably come up with some improved technologies for life extension, for life preservation. So maybe by this time, they have these stasis chambers. So maybe whether or not the former Anunnaki on this Earth are still here or they passed away, the new Anunnaki coming down for sure would have had some kind of survival technologies to survive on their journey through deep space, as well as when they send down new landing parties on Earth, have some kind of technologies to allow themselves to, the landing parties to survive for that 3,600 years before the planet would once again circle back here. Okay? So I'm wondering, the question mark, these giants that are in these stasis chambers, are they Anunnaki? And are they, the report says that it looks like they are showing signs of coming back to life. Okay? So are they, is this like a pre-programmed, within these stasis chambers, some kind of pre-programmed computer thing like we see in the movies where it reaches a certain time, a certain destination, and I'm thinking in the movie Aliens, you know, they're going through far out into space, and when they finally come within range of that planet, computers reactivate them in their stasis chambers and bring them back out of their stasis and back into life, and they come out of their capsules, you know, and stretch and yawn and start in on, you know, all their talk to each other, the way they talk, locker room talk kind of stuff, you know, and try to get focused on why they're out there and the mission that lies before them in dealing with these aliens. Okay, so what if the Anunnaki view us as aliens? What if they view us as not belonging here on their planet? What if they staked their claim to this planet long before mankind was ever placed here, and they think it's theirs? And when they come here, they have voracious appetites, and they won't think twice about making us into happy meals for them. Okay, that kind of thing. Any questions at this point? Anybody? Okay, I want to.
Yeah. I do want to toss this out there to you, brother. So I got an email real quick, because people, again, I believe the email is thepetersonchronicles@gmail.com if you want to reach Brother Lauren. But also, the question had been proposed to me, and I don't know anything about this stuff, you know, where could somebody, if it even exists, I realize that a lot of this doesn't exist. This is stuff that from your own research that you've, you know, derived, a lot of it is. And I agree with a lot of it. I think it makes complete sense. But someone had sent me an email and said, hey, can you hook me up? I'm really interested in this subject about, you know, that whole Lucy deal, you know, with what did you read that caused you to derive or come to the possible conclusion that Adam and Eve had all their DNA activated, or at least a large portion of it activated, and that over, you know, bunches of time, are through entropy and fallen state, we have diminished. I mean, somebody was like, oh, that is just the most fascinating. They're just very interested in it, and they asked me, you know, was there a book? Was there one particular source? Was there multiple sources that they could go to learn more about the DNA degradation dynamic?
Yeah. The first time I came to kind of understand that was back in 1975, reading that first book that God had me read. It was a secular book. I mentioned this before on the Chronicles, Colony Earth by Richard E. Mooney. It blew the barn doors off my thinking. Up to that point, I had many questions. You know, I was raised traditional in the church, so I knew the traditional stories. But being scientifically curious, I would like to read, like, Science Digest magazine and anything, you know, watching the original Star Trek series on TV and all these Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea, all these science fiction stuff, you know. So, you know, it brought up a lot of questions. And even like was Noah's flood true? Did it really happen? Okay. Well, that should be a no-brainer for us as Christians. Yes, it did happen, even if we cannot completely understand or describe exactly how it happened or why it happened exactly or how it exactly connects with the rock strata, geological strata. We may not be at that level of understanding, but we should be saying, yes, it did happen and was global in scale. But there's a lot of Christians who just believe that a lot of that stuff in the Old Testament was just, you know, especially that early stuff, was just stories for our spiritual benefit. Because they don't have the means or even the desire to dig deeper to try to connect with what science is bringing to the forefront. So it's like a schism in our understanding of things. So his book is what really helped me understand the Tower of Babel, because he mentioned that at one time in mankind's remote past, mankind had perfect memory recall. Well, you don't get perfect memory recall at 8% activation, right? Okay. Anybody out there with 8% activation, do you have perfect memory recall of everything? Okay. Can you read through a telephone book? There are some people in the world who can read an entire telephone book of every country on the planet and have it perfectly memorized. Okay, that's amazing. Okay, but that's not the normal experience for most of us. Okay, I can read through a phone book and put it down, and the next second I forgot what I looked at. You know, I'm on to something else. My focus is on something else. I could care less about memorizing a phone book. Okay, but in my subconscious memory, everything I read in that phone book is stored there and stored on my DNA. Whether I can recall it or not, it is permanently stored in my experience. Okay? That's how God designed our DNA. Now, taken from his understanding that at one time there was a super civilization, the Golden Age, where mankind had much greater capacities, but we've lost it since then. Okay? And I tied that directly into the Tower of Babel, because when you read the biblical account that the age spans before the flood were 900 plus years. After, between the flood and the Tower of Babel, it dropped down to roughly half. And then after the Tower of Babel, it dropped down even another, about another half, give or take. And even guys like Abraham lived to 175, and I think Isaac lived to be, I don't know, 180 years? Isaac? Folks, Isaac living to be 180 years. and like Abraham was still having kids well past 100. Okay, in our day and age, we can't even imagine living that long and being still productive. Okay, if I may be a little suggestive, sexually active, we would think somebody that old would be shriveled up, you know, bent over prune and not be able to do anything. Even sexually, okay, these guys were still active, okay, and they were reflective of the general population at large at that point in time. So even if we just look back to Abraham and Isaac's time compared to our time, we have lost ground. We are about, if you figure 180 years old for Isaac, you cut that in half, that's 90, that's about where we are at today. We've lost 50% of our capacity since Isaac's time. Does that sound like evolution to anybody? Okay. The theory of evolution is a complete fraud. Mankind has gone downhill. Now, does anybody think that God would have created Adam and Eve with all this DNA in their system, but only allowed 8% activation of all that DNA? When we contemplate that Adam and Eve were created in God's exact image and likeness, what does that mean? Do you think God, in creating Adam and Eve to be in his exact image and likeness, would have only given them 8% activation? Here's another 92%, but I'm not going to activate that for you. I'm just going to let you be at 8%. And then watch you stumble and fall and sin and everything. That's not God's heart. That's not his nature. To be in God's exact image and likeness tells me that God created Adam and Eve with full 100% activation of their DNA. There was no junk DNA, no alien DNA, no serpent DNA at that point. 100% activation. And that also helps explain what Stan and others, Stan Garcia and others have been saying in their research, based on their research, is that Adam and Eve had, quote-unquote, light bodies, which is what the Assyrians are dangling in front of us now as we can ascend into our light bodies, okay? Well, from the Assyrian perspective, a light body means you've been blasted, and if we pass on from our flesh bodies into our light bodies without Jesus Christ, we are being blasted right into hell, folks. The Assyrians might be in the sixth dimension, but as I said before, there's expiration date on all these nine dimensions. So don't be deceived. There's an expiration date. There will be a final judgment. So whether, even if you would be fortunate enough to ascend to the sixth dimension to escape the judgment that comes at the death of this flesh body, you're still under a death sentence. You're still under this expiration date, this final judgment that's coming unto the entire fallen one-third. Okay, so don't be deceived by these lies. These Syrians are lying. They're liars, okay? They're not telling you the truth. If somebody's not telling you the truth, that means they're a liar, right? So they're lying, but they're sugarcoating this stuff just like the serpent sugarcoated what he is taught, you know, in his deceiving of Eve. Do you think he just came out with blatant lies that you could see a million miles away? No, he was sugarcoating. He was sugarcoating that little speck of leaven so it tasted so good. Until that leaven got into your system, and then, oh, I got a real bad stomach ache, you know, from that leaven. Yeah, well, more than just a stomach ache, it introduced the sin matrix. The sin matrix that had gripped this fallen one-third was now within Adam and Eve, taking over their DNA, subjecting it, okay, degrading it over thousands of years of human history. So that's my opinion, that Adam and Eve were created at 100% activation. They were both flesh and light body at the same time. It's like this paradise, this place of paradise within the Garden of Eden was a direct connect of two points as though it was the same point at the same time. A direct connect between the earth and God's throne room or this planet heaven, whatever it may be, but there was a direct connect as if it was the same place at the same time. And the physicist, go ahead.
I got to just jump in here. About 5-6 years ago, I was teaching Bible back at my old church, and this girl came in. She was in her 20s. She just got saved. She was, like, glowing, you know, how you do when you're just, like, realizing what Jesus did for you. And she was exuberant. She had a glow about her, you know. She came into the group one night out of nowhere, sat down and shared Bible study. And in the midst of it, she said what you just said. And I pulled her aside after. I don't even remember her name. I said, where did you read that or where did you hear that? She said, I was just reading the beginning of the book of Genesis, and the Lord put it on my heart. And I said, you didn't read that somewhere? You didn't hear somebody say that? No, the Lord put that on my heart. And then she's never in our group again. I don't even know where she went or who she was, or she was gone. And when you were talking about that, it just struck me, this sweet young girl, and she gave her testimony. She came out of drugs, and she came out of a bad life, and the Lord just, like, instantly delivered her from this stuff, and she was praising the God. She sang what we worshipped a little bit in a small group, and this girl was just glowing, and boom, she's gone. And
yeah.
I'm listening to you talk now, and it sounds like this girl that was just out of nowhere. I don't even know who she was or what her name was. Then she's gone. I just wanted to share that
wow.
with you.
Yeah, amen. So, folks, right there in the Bible account itself is the written record in plain black and white, but it's usually not pointed out to us. If we've got, like, go to Bible studies and church studies and stuff, it's not pointed out to us. But it's right there in black and white. Anybody can read it, just like this girl did. That mankind's age has degraded over time. a major drop-off after the Noah's flood. And if and when we get to that point, we can go into deep detail on how that could be, how that could happen. And then another major drop-off after the Tower of Babel. And then we read about the patriarchs. And we generally think the patriarchs were not, you know, relatively speaking, that long ago, you know, Abraham and Isaac. And yet they had twice the lifespan as we have today. And they were not shriveled up, bent over, prunes. They were still, you know, active and strong, well into their old age, and capable of producing children. Isn't that amazing, folks? Even since Abraham and Isaac's time, we've fallen 50% since then, okay? Does that sound like mankind's evolved theory of evolution is a lie, okay? But if somebody wants to claim that they're ancestors or pond scum, well, I can see the resemblance. Okay, if you want to claim that your ancestors are the great apes of Africa, well, I can see the resemblance. But I'm not a descendant from pond scum. I'm not a descendant from the great apes. I'm not ascended from these Syrians. I'm from my father. That's why he's called father. Okay, that's why he's called my father. Because I came from my father, okay? That's why Jesus is called our elder brother, because he's my older brother. You can't get more personal. It's family, folks, family. You know, there's some cultures in the world that are very, very family-orientated, and then there's other cultures that are, they might be family-orientated, but they're kind of little, more relaxed, more what might appear to be standoffish, it's just the way how different people reflect their emotions, I guess. But there's some cultures like the Italians are very family-oriented, the Greeks, the Israelis, very family-oriented. And then there's other groups that are kind of opposite. But it's about family here, folks. Our father, our elder brother, it's family.
Praise God. And on that note, we have run out of time. We're down to the last 60 seconds. A good stopping place. Very exciting because it
Amen.
Is true. That's why we're called brothers and sisters. That's why Jesus
That's right.
stood in the tabernacle. He said, they were like, hey, there's your mom and your brothers out in the street. And Jesus goes, those aren't my mothers and my brothers. These are my mothers and my brothers and my sisters, those who do the will of my Father. We are all in this together. Praise God. And I can't wait to get out of here and get it back up there. Hallelujah. Let's get this over with. Praise Jesus. We'll see you all next Saturday.
God bless you all. Thank
Lord
you.
Willing.